Hi all, in this video lecture I am going to explain you about an timer A output in a continuous mode. Before getting into this, I hope everyone have a basic knowledge regarding a timer A, how it is going to be working. Now let us come to this output in a continuous mode. If a system has been put it in a continuous mode, that is nothing but a timer A, what all the things it is going to behave. Okay, always the counter is going to count from 0 to the maximum value of an FFFFH. Okay, why? Because means it is a 16 bit timer. The duration of the output signal must always be controlled by software. Okay, suppose if I put a system in a continuous mode, if I want to have an some different delays. Okay, for example, if you have taken to a full scale means, if you are operating with an A clock of 32 kilohertz, the maximum delay you can get is in 2 seconds. Suppose if you have put a timer A in a continuous mode, there you may require an some 0.5 seconds or 0.3 seconds. Okay, those things need to be controlled with a software by putting those value into any one of the channel, and in order to get that periodically you need to update manually. That is nothing but controlled by a software. Okay, now let us consider a scenario. The continuous mode is typically used in the following circumstances. When you are going to put a system in a continuous mode. So, I have told that your timer here has in 3 channels, channel 0, channel 1 and then channel 2. Suppose all the channels require a timer clock. Okay, at that time you are going to put it in a continuous mode. That is what here it has been written. All channels are needed for an output including channel 0. Output must be driven at a different and unrelated frequencies. Okay, one is operating at an 100 kilohertz or some another may be operating at an 100 hertz or an some 500 hertz. Okay, you want to have an some periodic delays. Okay, at that time you are going for a continuous mode. Or if you want to get an any single delay required rather than a periodic delay, at that time also you are going for that one. Some channels are used for capture and some other for compare events. Okay, always I cannot configure into an only capture mode and compare mode. Channel 0 may be used for a compare, channel 1 can be used for a capture, channel 2 can be either capture or compare. In those kind of scenarios we are going to put it in a continuous mode. Okay, the main thing you want to grasp in this stage is, okay, if you want to put a system in a continuous mode, just think that all the channels might be want to drive a timer clock with an undefined frequencies or an any unspecified time. Suppose the channels may be using in a capture as well as compare mode, at that time you are going to be operating your timer A in a continuous mode. Let us take an example. Okay, generation of independent periodic signals. Let's take the first one. Okay, LED 1 it has is driven by a timer A1 and toggled every 0.25 seconds so that it flashes within 50% duty cycle. That is nothing but it need to LED 1 need to drive from a timer A1. Okay, it need to turn on for 0.25 seconds and it need to turn off for 0.25 seconds. Okay, how we can derive that one I will discuss. Okay, that is the one condition. Then they have an another one LED2 driven from a timer A2 roughly at 100 hertz. Roughly at 100 hertz within 10% duty cycle. Okay, here it want to drive an LED2 within some other frequency, that is an 100 hertz within duty cycle of 10%. Okay, two conditions you have been got. Then the piezo sounder is driven nearly at 440 hertz. Okay, it need to run a sounder within 440 hertz. Okay, that is an A used for Western music. It is connected directly to a timer A, so its outputs are toggled in an interrupt service routine for channel 0. They have specified here this piezo sounder need to be used in a channel 0. With the help of an interrupt service routine, we need to toggle it. Okay, these are the three conditions it has been given. The last condition, this sounder is toggled on or off every 2 seconds. Okay, whatever the piezo sounder we have been used, this sounder need to be enabled for 2 seconds and another 2 seconds it need to be disabled. Okay, before getting into this scenario, we we require mainly three components. One is I need to get an 0.25 seconds delay and an 100 hertz with a 10% duty cycle, and another one is I need to get an 440 hertz. Okay, then finally I want to get an 2 seconds delay. Okay, now to get this one, what is the better clock source I want to use? Okay, if I want to get an 2 seconds delay, means obviously I need to go for an auxiliary clock, that is nothing but an A clock. In an A clock, I am going to get a maximum delay of an 2 seconds if it has been fully counted to FFFFH. Okay, that's why I will take an A clock, and from that A clock frequency, let us try to derive that 0.25 seconds or an 100 hertz on 440 hertz. Okay, let's do some calculation part before getting into a program. Okay, if I am using an A clock with a 32 kilohertz, means for each one count, I am going to get a 30.517 microseconds. Okay, that is the time period of a clock. If it is one clock, means I can get this delay. We can do it. Okay, now for a full scale count, that is 65536, or you can, this is decimal, you can call it in an hexadecimal FFFFH. Okay, if I try to multiply that with an 30.517, 0.517 I have missed. If I multiply, I am going to get in 2 seconds. Okay, now I got that for a full scale fluctuation, last condition is satisfied. Okay, if I am using a timer A interrupt flag, I can make sure that I will be getting a 2 second delay. There I can turn on or turn off and my piezo sound. One is satisfied. Okay, for 0.25 seconds delay, need to divide full scale by an 8. Okay, that is nothing but here I have 2 seconds. In order to get an 0.25, simply I need to divide this one by an 8, right? If I divide 65536 divided by 8, I am going to get an 8192, that is a decimal number. If I want to represent that with an hexadecimal number, it is a 2000. Okay, if I load in some of the channel register with a 2000, it is going to give an 0.25 seconds delay. Okay, our first condition is satisfied and last condition is satisfied. Now I want to get an 100 hertz. Okay, for 100 hertz, the time period is 0.01 second. Okay, now to get this 0.01 second, I need to divide 0.01 divided by this 30.517 microsecond. If I do that one, I am going to get an 327 count. Okay, if I getting this 327 count, that means in order to get a 10%, I may be getting an approximately an 31 or 32. Okay, in this program, what they have been done here is simply they have discarded this 27. They have considered as an 300 time period. You know, the 10% is simply they are going to take it as an 30. Okay, 300 10% is 30. They have been considered. They have been discarded an error. If you want, you can take in full things and you can do it. Okay, now in order to get a 440 hertz, the time period is 2.27 millisecond. For one count, we have a 30.517 milliseconds. In order to get 2.27, we are going to divide by that value. I am going to get 74.38. Okay, this is the full period. If I neglect this decimal part, I am going to get a 74. Okay, suppose it is a periodic, means 50% duty cycle, it need to be there. Simply, we are going to load with an 37. Okay, I hope everyone are clear with this calculations. Probably this part might have been covered in your interrupt also by Chetan sir, I think. Okay, now let us, before getting into that, let's try to see the interrupt vector table. These parts have been discussed in your interrupts chapter. Okay, these are the two location related to an timer A interrupts. Okay, for channel 0 we have a separate interrupt vector table. Then for channel 1, channel 2 and then timer A interrupt flag, it has been shared. Okay, while writing in the program, you can write with an ORG this location, or you can simply write timer A 0 vector or timer A vector, like that you can be writing. Okay, now let us come to the main part program. This too is an initialization. Okay, here I want to define all the delays. In our previous slide, we have been defined for LED 1, the count, it need to be xi is 2000 we have been taken. Then for LED 2 I need to have an duty cycle as well as full time period. In order to declare those things, they have been taken in two, LED 2 duty and LED 2 period. Here they have been taken duty within 30, LED 2 period within 300. I have told that they have been round off that 327 to 300. Okay. Then for pizza off, there I have gotten 74. In order to get a 50% toggling, here I have been taken within 37. Okay. This is the starting initialization part. Now let us come to the main program part. Okay. In the main program part, we are going to disable an watchdog timer. Okay. Channel 0 has been connected to an piezoelectric buffer, right? That's why for an TACCR0 resistor, I am going to load the piece off value. Okay. Then I am going to enable the TACCTL0. This is an timer A control resistor within 0 channel. Just I am enabling an interrupt pin. Then in a channel 1, we have an LED 1. Okay. That's why for TACCR1, I have been taken an LED 1 off. Okay. Then in a timer A control register channel 1, I am going to put a device in an output mode 4. Output mode 4 is nothing but a toggle mode. Okay, I am putting in a toggle mode and I am going to enable an interrupt. Okay, then in a channel 2, I am going to load with an LED duty. Okay, initially I am going to load with a duty. This LED 2 period will be loaded during an interrupt service routine. I will discuss in the next slide. Okay, here in this one, we are going to make TACCL2, that is nothing but a timer A capture control register. Here I am putting a device in an output mode 1. Okay, that is nothing but a set mode. Okay, first it is going to set to a 10% duty cycle. Okay, for a full rest of the times, we are going to make it a reset in a timer enter. Here I am just enabling. Okay, now you can see that here I have been used in all the three channels, channel 0, channel 1, channel 2. Fine. Okay, in the main program, rest thing is I need to enable the ports. Okay, in port 1 out, we are enabling a 0th bit and then first bit. Okay, that is nothing but if I am making these two bits to an I means those two bits will become to an out. I am writing to an 1-1 value. Okay, then in an P1 DIR, I am making sure that it has been enabled as an output. Okay, if it is 0 means it is going to be acting as an input. Then in P2 select, we are going to select a bit 3 and a bit 4. That is nothing but in a port 2, it has been enabling a port 2.3 to a timer A1 channel and port 2.4 to a timer A channel 2. Okay, here it has been taking a channel 1 to an LED 1. This for channel 2, it has been taking an LED 2. Okay, then in an P2 out, they are making sure that bit 0, bit 3 and then bit 4 are met to an high value. Then port 2 DIR, we have been enabling those pins to an output, bit 0, bit 3, bit 4 and then bit 5. That is an piezo and an LED buffer. Okay, then I need to initialize a timer control register. Here I want to select an A clock, that's why TA select 1 and I am not dividing that. Just I am using a 32 kilohertz only. I am putting a timer into a continuous mode. Then I have been using a TSALR clearing a counter to 0 initially. Then I am enabling an interrupt. Then I am putting device into a low power mode 3. In low power mode 3 only A clock will be active. Okay, this is the main part what we have been done. Then I need to write an interrupt service routine. Okay, as you all know that channel 0 has a separate interrupt vector table and channel 1, 2 and then timer A interrupt is been sharing with a timer A1 interrupt vector table. Okay, that's why here we can see pragma vector is timer A0 vector. This is for a channel 0, 1. Then here we have a pragma vector timer A1 vector. Here we are going to write for channel 1, 2 and then timer A interrupt. First let us try to write for a timer A vector. Okay, here ISR void. Okay, here I am taking an P2 out. Okay, for here our piezo sounder has been selected. Okay, here we have been toggling with an bit 0 and an bit 5. For these two means our piezo electric sounder has been connected. This cap is an XOR configuration. Okay, as you all know that if you write this one with an previous output, it is going to toggle with this value. If you do an XOR with an previous value, it is keep on toggling, right? Now, here TSCR 0 plus is equal to piece of, as you all know that from, if you write it in this fashion, TSCR 0 is equal to TSCR 0 plus piece of. Okay, here it has been loading with an rest of the cycle. Piece of, that is nothing but an 37. Okay, why I want to add this one? Okay, in order to be continuously periodic, I need to make sure that TSCR 0 has been continuously, whenever an interrupt has been occurred, it is going to be updated to the next value, that is an 37 updated. Okay, if once in the starting it has been an 37, next if it had been added 74, it is going to be changing. Okay, continuously this PO2 make sure that it has been toggling and the compare register value has been continuously updating for an every interrupt. Okay, why it want to be plus here? Okay, why? Because means my timer A is in an continuous mode, it is going to run for a full scale, that's why I need to get an periodic in terms of an interrupt service routine I need to be updating. I hope everyone are clear with this piezoelectric interrupt service routine. Now let us come to the LED1, LED2 and then to turning off that piezoelectric buffer for every after 2 seconds. Okay, as you all know that channel 1, channel 2 and then timer interrupt flag shares the same interrupt vector. Okay, the highest priority interrupt is in channel 1, then channel 2, then finally the least priority is in timer A interrupt flag. Okay, as you all know that the interrupt wide timer ISR automatically get loaded with an value to an TIV with an most highest priority interrupt flag. Okay, that is nothing but here we have been written and switch even in a range TIV comma 10. Okay, this even in a range means it makes sure that it has been pointing to an even location. Then a timer A interrupt vector value will be loaded. According to that, it is going to switch. Okay, if there is no interrupt, it will be simply pointing to an 0. Simply it will break and come out of the loop. Okay, if it has been having an value 2, this is due to an channel 1. If it is having an 4, the interrupt is due to an channel 2. Then if this TIV is 10, then it is going to be interrupt with an value of an timer A interrupt flag. Okay, now you got the things that, okay, if TIV having a respective number, you will be knowing that which interrupt has been there. Okay, now let us try to address with an LED1. Okay, if it is with an channel 1, once it has become to a channel 1, what I need to do, I need to simply update that TSCR1 value with an LED1 off. Okay, that is nothing but for every 0.25 seconds it need to on and off. Okay, with the channel output mode itself we have been made and toggle there. Okay, that's why it is going to be toggling there itself. Only thing is I need to update and counter value, that's why we have been added an LED1 off. Okay, now LED1 has been solved. Now let us see for an LED2, that is nothing but an TIV CCIFG2. Okay, here I need to update the value in a 2 scenario. Okay, whether if it is within starting time, then I need to update within duty cycle, that is in 30. If it is on the reset side, I need to update within value within LED period minus duty, that is nothing but an 270 value it need to be updated. I need to check the value. Okay, that's why if TSCCL2 and then it is in an output mode 4. Okay, if it is in an output mode 4, that is nothing but an toggling state. Okay, if it is in that state, okay, that is output 4 means and toggle or reset it is going to be checking. If earlier it was an reset, that is nothing but an it was in a 0th position. Okay, if it is 0 means next thing I need to update is and duty cycle. That's why we are taking an TSCCR2 plus with an LED2 duty. Then I am making once again configuring a control register to an output mode 1 CCIE. Okay, set turns and LED off next state. Okay, else my TSCCR2 should be updated with an LED 2 period minus LED 2 duty, that is a 270 value. Then once again I am been configuring a capture control register to an output mode 5. Okay, here output 5 means it is going to reset. Okay, then it is breaking. Okay, here it has been taking in two scenarios. If earlier action was in reset, it is going to update it with an LED duty. If it was in set, it is going to be taking to a full value, and on a reset, it is going to convert into a mode 5. Okay, this is with respect to channel 2. Then finally, I need to write for a timer A interrupt flag. Okay, this is going to be generated for every 2 seconds. Okay, for every 2 seconds, what I need to do, I need to make sure that TSCCTL0 bit capture control interrupt flag need to be enabled or disabled. Okay, if I am disabling means CCIE, it is going to disable this part. Okay, if it is enabled means this service routine is going to be served, otherwise it is not going to serve. Okay, here I have been written an XOR. Okay, that is nothing but every 2 seconds it is going to on and it is going to be off. Okay, now my piezo sounder is turning on and off for every 2 seconds. Okay, then it is an for infinite loop. I hope everyone are clear. Okay, just if I want to conclude, this part is going to serve a piezo sounder with an 440 hertz. Then in a channel 1 it is going to serve an LED 1. In channel 2 it is going to serve an LED 2 with an 100 hertz, that is a 10% duty cycle on and an off. That's why here you have 2 statements. Then in order to turn and turn off this for every 2 seconds, we have served with a TIFG flag. Thank you for watching.